Hello there. I'm Stephen Bunting and I'm a physiotherapist working in the northwest of England. If you're new to the channel and want to know a bit more about me and why I'm making these videos, then click up here or see the link in the description below. Okay, so today's topic is plantar fasciitis, also known as plantar fasciopathy or just plantar heel pain. As usual, please note that this video is for general information only and assumes that you've already been diagnosed with plantar heel pain. Or maybe you're just interested in learning a bit more about the condition in general. As with all my videos, I'll be tackling the condition by answering the three most common questions asked by patients. Number one, what is it? Number two, why have I got it? And number three, what can I do about it? What are my options? Okay, so on to question one, what is it? Well, the word plantar just refers to the sole of the foot, and the tissue involved in the condition is called the plantar fascia. It's a triangular shaped sheet of strong connective tissue made up of dense collagen fibres, similar to a ligament. Its apex attaches to the heel bone and its base to the forefoot, specifically the bases of all five toes. The plantar fascia has a role in maintaining the main arch of your foot, and when it becomes overloaded, it can cause symptoms, usually at the point where it attaches to the heel bone, just here. The term itis is derived from the ancient Greek and means inflammation. So plantar fasciitis describes inflammation of the plantar fascia. But when we look at people who have the condition, we don't often see true inflammation. We instead see thickening and degeneration of the fibres that make up the plantar fascia. And so the more correct term is plantar fasciopathy, as opathy means degeneration. Both these terms are a bit of a mouthful though, and so my preference is the other common term used to describe the condition, plantar heel pain. I like it because no matter what specifically is going on with the plantar fascia, whether it's inflamed, degenerative, or a bit of both, everyone who has it will universally have pain in the plantar heel region. So, it describes the problem perfectly, and it's the term I will use throughout this video. Here is an ultrasound scan of someone with a normal plantar fascia and someone with plantar heel pain. See how thickened the plantar fascia is in the plantar heel pain patient, almost twice as thick in this case. This is due to disorganisation and degeneration of the collagen fibres which make up the plantar fascia. So the main symptom of plantar heel pain is pain right here on the part of the heel that takes the most body weight. It's usually quite sore to touch, but as it's a deep tissue, you might have to press quite firmly in order to feel any tenderness. The pain is always worse when your weight is going through your heel, so usually when standing, walking or running. And it's often worst immediately after rest, and particularly first thing in the morning when you first put your foot on the floor. And it can take a good few minutes to settle down, but then is typically painful throughout the day, depending on how much time you spend on your feet. Resting with your foot off the floor is usually the most comfortable position. Okay, so that's plantar heel pain in a nutshell. Now, let's discuss question two. Why have I got it? Well, the first thing to say is that you are by no means alone. This is unfortunately a very common condition, particularly in the 40 to 60 age group. It accounts for between 11 and 15% of all foot complaints to healthcare professionals, and it occurs in about 8 to 10% of regular runners. It's slightly more common in females and in people who have repetitive and manual occupations where they stand a lot. It's not just runners and manual workers though. In fact, a recent UK-based study found almost 10% of the general over 50s population had some symptoms of plantar heel pain. So as you can see, it's a very common problem. And it's essentially an overuse condition. It's caused when the plantar fascia becomes overloaded to the point where its collagen fibres begin to degenerate. And it's really important to understand this if you want to help settle down the symptoms. Plantar heel pain is caused because you are exceeding the capabilities of your plantar fascia. Basically, you're doing more walking, running or standing than your plantar fascia can cope with. And what it can cope with is mainly determined by your lifestyle and your foot posture. The two biggest risk factors for developing the condition are an inactive lifestyle and being overweight. It's also seen more often in people with certain foot postures, particularly a low plantar arch, which can put extra strain on the plantar fascia and make it more vulnerable to developing the condition. It's also more common with conditions like diabetes, which is known to affect collagen health, particularly if it isn't well controlled. So, by having an unhealthy plantar fascia and then suddenly starting to do more walking or standing than it can cope with, well, that's the most common reason for developing the condition. However, you may not have any of those risk factors and have a perfectly healthy plantar fascia, but you're just overloading it with activities beyond your usual level. For example, you might have taken up running and have increased your distances too quickly for your plantar fascia to adapt. Pushing a new sport too far and too fast is the next most common reason for developing the condition. And it's a scenario familiar to all MSK physios as it causes many different sports related injuries, including most of the tendonitis problems plagued by recreational runners. Anyway, that's for another video. So back on point and on to the final question, which is the one most people with the condition will be keen to learn about. What can you do about it? What are the treatment options? Well, in a nutshell, there is good news and bad news. The good news is that it will usually get better by itself in the majority of cases. The bad news is that it can take a long time. 1 to 2 years is not unusual. And unfortunately, despite what you might see online, there is no quick fix and no reliable treatment that works for everyone. In fact, if you Google treatments for plantar fasciitis, you will find a myriad of different suggestions, which should ring alarm bells that we don't really have a good, reliable treatment that works for everyone. And this can obviously cause much confusion, wasted time, and wasted money. The best evidence we have comes from clinical research, and a large study published in 2021 has collected the best available evidence from published research, the opinions of 14 experts, and also 40 patients with the condition. And they have come up with a consensus of the 5 most useful self-help treatment options for plantar heel pain. And these are: number 1, managing load. Now, it might sound a bit obvious, but this was found to be the single most effective way of reducing symptoms. We spoke before about the causes of plantar heel pain being overloading of the plantar fascia. Well, in order to get it better, we have to reduce the load and give the plantar fascia a period of relative rest in order to give it a chance to go through a normal healing process. But what is relative rest? Well, it isn't total rest from walking and general weight bearing. It's a general reduction in the activities that are causing the pain, whether that's standing, walking, or running. And you have to reduce these activities to the degree where pain starts to improve. This will be different for different people, but as a general rule, you should be reducing your weight-bearing activities until the pain becomes mild and manageable while doing that activity, and the pain doesn't worsen again the next day. If you still get a lot of discomfort while standing or walking, and if it feels worse the next day, then you're still doing too much and you're still aggravating the condition. This may take a bit of experimentation, but it's really vital that you stop aggravating the plantar fascia, or you're going to be fighting a losing battle. A step counter or a smartwatch can be really helpful in giving you some feedback about how much time you're spending on your feet, and you can then relate this to your symptoms in order to find out what you can manage and, more importantly, what is too much for you. Number 2, the next thing to consider is general footwear. The researchers found that walking in barefoot or in flat, unsupportive shoes such as flip-flops or Converse-type shoes aggravated the condition, while more supportive shoes, typically well-fitted trainers, were the most comfortable. Number 3. The next self-help treatment found to be useful by the researchers was taping. Applying tape in a way that supports the plantar arch was found to help reduce pain in the short term. Many different techniques have been described, but perhaps the most commonly used is the low dye taping technique, which I'll put a link to up here or in the description below. However, taping is time consuming and can be awkward to apply yourself, and so you might be best moving straight to treatment 4, which is the use of supportive insoles. Insoles are generally easier to use and do a better long-term job of supporting and cushioning the foot. There are two main types of insoles for plantar heel pain. The first are the gel heel pressure relief inserts that essentially spread the pressure over the heel and reduce pain when standing and walking. The second are the arch support insoles. And if you have a low arch, then these can be helpful in taking the stretch off the plantar fascia when you're standing. You can also find insoles that do both jobs, and I'll put a link in the description for all three types. The main thing is that they should be comfortable and certainly not increase the pain. If you struggle to find something that suits your foot, then you could consider seeing a podiatrist for custom fit insoles that are moulded to your specific foot posture. Whatever insoles you use though, you should wear them pretty much all of the time when you're on your feet. Move them from shoe to shoe as needed, or buy a few pairs. I say pairs, as even though your other foot may be perfectly fine, it's best to use insoles for both feet together, so not to throw you off balance. Number 5. The last self-help treatment supported by the research are the exercises and stretches. Stretches are often advised for plantar heel pain, but whilst they can make you feel better for a short time, they don't tend to do much else. When combined with strengthening exercises though, the combined treatments seem to be much more effective. However, you should start exercising only when the pain is under some control by managing your load as discussed earlier. There's no point in exercising a highly irritable plantar fascia when it needs to be rested. Allow it to calm down with the other treatments we've talked about first, before starting exercises, and then start with easy ones before progressing in baby steps to more challenging exercises. The key is that they should always be fairly comfortable, or rather minimally uncomfortable, if that makes sense. You certainly shouldn't be wincing with pain as you do them, and any discomfort should settle down quickly. I've done a separate video to demonstrate a suitable stretch and exercise program, which I'll put a link to up here. Another pain relief option, which wasn't covered in this paper, but which other studies have found can be helpful for that early morning pain, are the night splints. The reason why plantar heel pain is worse in the morning is because the plantar fascia shortens overnight when the foot is relaxed, and it then stretches abruptly when you put your weight through it again. So a splint to lift the foot up and keep the plantar fascia on a bit of stretch is usually helpful in reducing that morning pain. There are two general types available, the ones which pull your foot up like this, and the ones which support the foot from underneath like this. The second type is usually the most comfortable. They don't work for everyone, but if morning pain is a particular problem for you, then it's worth giving them a try, as they're fairly inexpensive. Again, I'll put a link to them in the description below. Lastly, if you just can't reduce your weight-bearing activities enough, or your heel pain is really severe and irritable, then we would usually then recommend an immobilisation boot. This is usually fitted by a healthcare professional, but you can buy them online, and I'll put a link in the description. A boot will prevent all foot and ankle movement and therefore offload the plantar fascia as much as possible. They need to be worn for at least 6 weeks and sometimes longer. They come off at night and when driving, but stay on pretty much all the time otherwise. They are commonly used with Achilles tendon injuries, so you've probably seen people using them. They look a bit like a ski boot. They are a bit cumbersome at first, but you do get used to them, and they are effective in reducing the pain. Okay, well that pretty much completes the self-help section. Any other self-help treatments that you see online are not supported by the evidence, at least as of December 2021. So don't waste your time or money. Also, ignore the silly clickbait videos that claim to cure plantar heel pain in a week or other such nonsense. If your plantar heel pain gets better in a week, then it wasn't plantar heel pain in the first place. Now, if you're really struggling with plantar heel pain and haven't had a great response to the self-help treatments we've discussed, then I'll briefly talk about some of the other evidence-based treatments available from healthcare professionals. When I say evidence-based, I mean that there are studies that show that these treatments can sometimes be helpful for some people with the condition, but the evidence is weak. They're certainly not a guaranteed cure, and you'll need to discuss your individual case with a healthcare professional specialising in foot and ankle conditions. First up is a cortisone injection. Now, this was a commonly used treatment, but has fallen out of favour over recent years, as the evidence has shown it's not as helpful as we first thought, and indeed, it can potentially be harmful. We do know that they can work well in the short term, but more often than not, the pain will return in a few weeks or months, and the patient then comes back asking for another. And this is where the problems arise, because we now know that with each repeated injection, there is an increased risk of causing long-term weakness of those collagen fibres, which can then cause the plantar fascia to completely rupture, or it can cause thinning and weakness of the plantar fascia that ultimately prolongs the condition, causing exactly the opposite effect of what we want with treatment. As a result, I rarely provide injections now, and if I do, it's only ever as a one-off, and then only in certain cases when I'm happy that the plantar fascia looks fairly healthy on ultrasound imaging. The other treatments I'm going to talk about all work on the premise that plantar heel pain can be considered a type of injury where the healing process becomes stuck, and by trying to re-injure the plantar fascia in a controlled way, we try and kick-start this healing process and stimulate recovery of the degenerative collagen fibres. The first of these provocative treatments is extracorporeal shockwave therapy. This is a treatment which uses high-pressure sound waves to disrupt the collagen fibres in a way that stimulates a healing response. It's a treatment that usually lasts around 10 minutes and is typically delivered once a week over a 3-week period. It will cause a temporary increase in pain, as it's essentially re-injuring the plantar fascia in order to prod it into kick-starting that healing process. Patients are then reviewed about 6 weeks later, when the treatment can be repeated if needed. Another way of trying to stimulate this healing response is to cause some bleeding around the plantar fascia. We know that blood contains various growth and repair factors that initiate healing when you have an injury. By hijacking this system, we can try to encourage the plantar fascia to repair itself. The easiest way of doing this is by using a needle to cause some disruption and local bleeding. Acupuncturists can do this, but it can be an uncomfortable process. A better way is using some local anaesthetic and then inserting a normal hypodermic needle under ultrasound guidance directly into the painful part of the plantar fascia. The needle tip is then used a bit like a mini scalpel in order to injure the collagen fibres and cause some bleeding. Because you're trying to cause local inflammation, you shouldn't use anti-inflammatory medication like ibuprofen for 2 weeks before or after the procedure. The latest treatment technique takes this process a step further. A process called PRP, or platelet-rich plasma, involves taking some blood from the patient, spinning it in a centrifuge, and then separating out the platelets, which contain all those growth and repair factors, and then injecting this concentrated platelet-rich plasma back into the plantar fascia. PRP is becoming more widely available, but you might struggle to find it being offered on the NHS at the moment because it's still an area of active research and the jury is still out regarding its overall effectiveness. And finally, for the most severe cases that have resisted treatment and the passage of a few years, surgery is sometimes considered as a last resort option. There are a number of different procedures offered, but results are quite variable, and as such, most surgeons will be reluctant to operate in all but the most severe cases. And that's it. I do hope that the video has provided some useful information. Don't forget to check out the exercise and stretch video as well. Thanks very much for watching, and bye for now.